Okay, sorry about the delay. Welcome everybody to this panel discussion that's been organized as part of the 5th Central Conference. I'm Zainab Bawa from HasGeek, and my team members are here. There's Kiran, Chandna, Radha, Tony, who's outside busy coordinating the event. We organize technology conferences for developers. One of our upcoming conferences is in July called the 5th Elephant, which is a conference on big data and analytics. This year, we were very curious to see what really happened in the elections that just concluded recently, how data was used, how technology was used, and that motivated us to put this panel together. I'd like to thank Arun Ram, who came in at the fairly last minute to help us moderate this panel. And the format of the event has changed. I'm going to let Arun introduce the format of the event shortly. Arun is leads a business unit at Tech Mahindra. On a personal side, he's very passionate about technology and the possibilities that technology presents. Arun has been one of the organizers of the earlier bar camps, and is also a very active Wikipedian and co-founder of Wikimedia India. I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank the Centre for Internet and Society, who has graciously provided us the venue today and the support here. Like Eleanor to say a few words about the CIS and let the audience know about CIS, and then Arun will take over.
Okay. I'm Eleanor Hickok. I'm the Program Manager for Internet Governance here at CIS. And we just wanted to give a warm welcome to everybody. CIS is a six-year-old think tank policy NGO, and we work in a number of different areas, including freedom of expression, privacy, surveillance, access to knowledge, telecom, so a wide range of different areas. And we're very happy and privileged to work closely with HasGeek, and yeah, we hope everyone enjoys the panel discussion today.
So over to you all and the panelists.
Hello.
Okay. Okay, good evening everybody. My name is Arun, and thanks for coming up here in good numbers. Friday evening is not a time perhaps to, in Bangalore City, to sit and watch a panel discussion, but perhaps sit in a pub. So thanks for coming over, and hope you find the next couple of hours interesting. Obviously, we've had a very exciting general elections, and the world has been watching us. All of you have been actively participating in some form or the other. So this evening, we are here to sort of sit and discuss what sort of role did technology play in elections 2014? How did the different parties and how did the different stakeholders in the whole election process use technology, and what came out of it really? I've got a very eminent panel here, and some of them are very, very distinguished people. So first of all, a big round of applause for them. A louder round of applause. Right. So first of all, to my left is Mr. B.G. Ramesh.
Mahesh, sorry.
Could you please raise your hand? Thank you. He's founder and managing director of One India. And he is a technocrat, and he's done a lot of work in technology, specifically around Indian languages and in the internet specifically. His organization is very reputed for what work they do at this intersection. He's been a very key part of the Modi campaign, and I will perhaps let him add a few words to introduce himself.
So, I actually have been involved in the portals and in the Indian languages for more than, say, about 15 years, and that was the reason why I was asked to be involved, like, in the digital, the campaign of, of Modi, and my involvement in that campaign was in my personal capacity, and my company is not actually part of the campaign.
Thank you. Yeah. I'm pleased to introduce the next gentleman on the panel, Mr. Vijay Grover. Vijay is the founder of the Bangalore Media Foundation, which is involved in skill enhancement projects in the media. The Bangalore Media Foundation has a project, Pledge to Vote, which played a crucial role in voter awareness building Vijay has been a TV journalist for 17 plus years and has been involved in the media coordination for various campaigns and various campaigns. So, would you like to add a few words?
Good evening, everybody. In fact, I'm pleased to be here to be able to share my thoughts with you, because this is something that certainly we need to discuss, because any such interaction is a learning for me as well. And I feel that, you know, this is going to be something where we're going to learn from each other in the next couple of hours to be able to understand as to how technology is driven this particular election, and as far as future elections are concerned, how the voters need to be aware of what technology can do for them and what they need to learn about political parties. So that's going to be my take on this.
Right. The next panelist, last panelist out there, is Viral Shah. He's a co-creator of the Julia language and has formerly worked on the Aadhaar UID project and was part of the team that strategized and executed Nandan Nilekani's campaign. Would you like to say a few words to introduce yourself?
Yeah, hi, so I'm Viral, and I think the only other thing I'd like to add is that to execute this campaign, we actually set up a firm called Fourth Line Technologies, and which executed a lot of the digital and technology parts of this campaign, which we'll talk more about. I think that's all I have to say. I think the point, I'll be talking predominantly about the Bangalore South campaign that we executed, so all my comments will be more local, perhaps, my colleagues will have more national perspective.
Yeah, so in summary, we have an independent view from an eminent journalist, another gentleman who's been part of the BJP campaign, and the other gentleman who's been part of Nandan's campaign. Perhaps the conspicuous absence is someone from the AAP party, and I think the organizers did reach out to them, but they weren't able to participate in this event. So without much ado, let's get started. I'll probably give you a view of how this event is being structured, and then this is designed to let you folks interact with the panelists as best as we go in the session. So let me just give you a view of how this is being organized. We have four segments for the day. Initially, we'll start off with just on the introductions. We'll kick off the four segments. And in each of the segments, we will have, it's like an open format where the panelists will share their views. I might post an odd question which will trigger their discussion. And then at the end of the section, we will have about 10 odd minutes for open discussions with all of you. And Jace, are we having interaction from online as well? Alright, no worries. So there are four segments for the day, so let me just introduce those four segments as such. The first segment is focused around how do different parties and organizations look at the demography using technology, how do they look at applying technology for the campaigns at multiple levels, the central level, the state level, and the candidate level. I'm sure you'll appreciate it's a fairly large country with its own complexities, so applying technology has its own nuances as well. The second part of the segment will be purely focused around web as a channel. What did they do differently to reach out to the potential voter through their websites, different languages, etc. That's the second focus. And the third one, of course, is something that everybody uses and talks about, which is social media. How did these organizations, parties, use social media, essentially your Facebooks and YouTubes and Twitters in terms of their campaign? Of course, not forget WhatsApp as well, which played a huge role this year in terms of influencing people's thoughts and views as well. And of course, the last one is, of course, the mobility segment, which is in terms of mobile applications that people created, either for candidates or for parties or for, you know, state organizations, in order to get the message of either the manifestos or what the candidates look for. So that's, in a sense, is the four segments we have today. And you folks will be interacting quite often in the session right through, rather than keep on the Q&A together. Is that okay from a format perspective? All right. So let's get started. We'll start off with the first segment, if folks are all fine. Like I said, the first segment is more focused around, let's first start with the first question. What, in your opinion, do you think was the role of technology in this campaign to start? Obviously, we all know that there were various different ways in which voters were influenced. Perhaps it was the candidates themselves speaking at rallies. It was perhaps the national media, particularly broadcast media. And of course, there was technology, there were door-to-door campaigns, etc. And so I just want to pose the question to the panelists in terms of their own takes on what part of influencing voters did the technology aspect play? And how do you compare it with the others? So I'd like to hear your takes. Perhaps we'll start with Vijay.
The BJP was the only one which had the campaign, the portal, you know, for the party and for all the candidates. So combined, we were the only ones who had and which was being constantly updated. So now I would say that here, the technology was used a lot by which the content, whatever we were publishing, was used as a very good source for the mainstream media, because it had become very difficult for either you say the print or the TV or journalists, in general were not able to get the news about the rallies, the photos from each of the rally. So I would say that in that way, using the technology, we were able to reach the people who could spread the information about the campaign in lot more. Example, not everybody has access to internet, but they have access to the print or the TV. But so from our portal, the content was so going into all these the media channels.
Yeah, so actually for us, the technology was sort of the blood, like the blood in the body is like going to every organ, right? And the technology was part of everything we did in the Nandan Nilekani campaign. And of course you can do everything without technology, right? I mean, the world existed without any technology 20 years ago for the most part. But today, technology is an integral part of any business process or anything we do. Difficult to imagine how you do something in today's world without technology. And right from the website or social media is something that you would have seen, but we use technology. Let me give you some examples where all we used it, right? For example, every time one of our volunteers knocked on someone's door, and we had almost close to 100,000 door knocks that we ended up with, we recorded as many of these door knocks or touches to a voter, for example, through an app. All the analytics and all this will come to a later at a later point, or every interaction on social media. So on every phone call, every SMS, even a letter that we sent to every voter. So technology is behind everything, and I mean it would be very difficult to run a campaign, at least after having run this one. I cannot imagine how one could run a campaign without technology. That's my personal.
Coming from the voter's point of view, one thing I want to share is that the voter this time was taken by surprise by the use of technology by all political parties. The BJP had a head start in this. I remember I was still in active journalism around September when One India started the groundwork.
One India didn't start. It is India 272.
India 272.
Yeah,
we were at the same center. Sorry. When India 272 started the groundwork at Jayanagar, and I was still as a journalist, had gone there. I could not get access to their office and could not get an interview with them. Mahesh was in Mumbai. But one of the things also is the fact that technology per se was not only used to the advantage of the political parties, it was also misused. And that's something that the voters realized much later, maybe most of them only on the polling day. Now, how it was misused is one thing, where the digitization of the electoral rules, one aspect that comes to mind. Deletions became such a common thing. We noticed that in 2013, there was a Pledge to Vote Foundation that we formed in 2012. Clearly noticed that a lot of voters could not get a chance to vote because there was random deletions. It only needed one operator to delete an entire page or that kind of thing, instead of scratching off names. So this is the kind of complaints that we got in 2013. So as Pledge to Vote, we started to work as early as November, where we found that collusion of some BJP officials with ground level political workers across parties. I would not blame one party for it. Across parties, the only thing that they used technology for was to ensure that person X is not my potential voter, his name should be deleted. Person Y, the other party felt, was not his voter, his name should be deleted. This is something which forced us to go to the High Court. there were several organizations which fight for voters' rights. We'd gone and got a stay on 16th of December, where any deletions after that were prevented using this thing. And that's where technology has its advantages. No doubt it made campaigns clearer, it made campaigns easier. But as far as the voter is concerned, most of the voters presume that their names would be there just because they had the voter ID card. They assume that they are going to be a part of the electoral process, only to realize much later that their names are deleted. So that is where we had fought this cause, and we got a stay. And luckily, after December, there were no further deletions. And that's something which all the voter awareness campaigns could do. So this is something where we need to also figure out as to how technology has to be adopted by the voter himself. Because this is something that's going to be only becoming difficult in the future. Because the segregation that most candidates, I'm not saying about BJP or the communist kind of thing, is that at random search, put 500 names, you're able to find out the voter's religion. So you know which are your strong areas, which are your weak areas. And this happened across the country. And this is something which makes us imagine, you know, the kind of idea I had where Abhishek Bachchan had said that, you know, everybody should have a mobile number instead of a name, because the name is a giveaway. So those kind of things where, you know, the identity, the real identity of the voter has to be protected, that he cannot be marked by a political party as a person belonging to this religion or this caste and should be either promoted or ignored.
I would like the panelists to throw some light into how did you conceive your strategy for technology before the campaign? How did you decide? How did you go about deciding how you would apply to the center state campaign?
So if you see the, you know, the portal which we built, which is a platform for the volunteers actually. The reason this happened was Mr. Modi was getting every day, I think, like at least 600 emails to 1,000 emails every day across the country, where everybody said they wanted to be involved with him, like, you know, for 1 year or 6 months. And a few people were telling from home, you know, they will be able to contribute, whether in copywriting or, you know, creative stuff or whatever it is. So at that point, he felt that, you know, we needed the platform where we could bring in all the volunteers. And it is that way we actually started this entire thing. Actually, you know, whatever we have done, implemented, I would say the main features, it all came from him. We just implemented everything. It came from him. So we had the platform where we had the your parliamentary, you know, your constituencies across the country. So everyone who actually, you know, he signed up for the volunteering was able to say he's in which place, and he was also able to inform us that in what way he's able to contribute. So that way we knew that, you know, which areas in the country are savvy with the net. So we saw obviously the very big cities were there on a platform, Pune, Mysore, and West Bengal. From there we saw the amount of people who were there. You know, it was actually good. But when they, you know, they signed up, if they signed up through the Facebook, we would know their actual profile because their name, age, etc. But if they would fill up the form which we had, I mean, you know, except for the email address, there are many times people give the fake information. So the average age, I would say, was anywhere from 21 to, say, 30, you know, were actually volunteered.
So candidates, from your perspective, candidates ran their campaigns on technology. They had to build on their own, or it was sent to
No, so for each of the candidate, when they had to do the digital one, you know, they would do on their own, but they would also do with us, because we had your volunteers from in their actual constituents. But the creatives, the content, all would go from us to all the candidates.
Okay. Any of you would like to add in terms of overall strategy that was applied in terms of how it was conceived at the start of the campaign?
So in our campaign, given that you were focused on a very specific geography, which was Bangalore South, you know, the preparatory work involved sort of understanding the lay of the land, which is, you know, the constituency, which, I mean, any guesses from anyone how large a parliamentary constituency is, how many registered voters, maybe the force interaction is something
else? Yes. Answers? Louder, please.
For Bangalore South, he's saying about 1 million voters.
That's actually 2 million. 1 million actually cast the vote. I mean, 11 lakh votes were cast, but actually the size of the voter list is 20 lakh voters. And the area is fairly large. I mean, you know, the entire population of Bangalore is split into three constituencies, and then there's Bangalore rural. So, you know, jumping in as a new candidate and a team which was sort of inexperienced with politics and campaigning at the start of the campaign, how do you get to understand, you know, what is the kind of area, what are the kind of people here, what do they think, what are their aspirations, you know, what are the demographics like, what are the issues that they will vote on in the election? What was the past electoral performance of this region? You know, are there some regions that behave differently? Are there pockets of one kind versus another kind? So,
could you be louder?
They just give you the what's available on the EC website. You don't get anything more than that. So you have to make do with those PDF files. Yeah, we looked at we extracted the, you know, whatever data was available, publicly available from the electoral rolls for our analysis and execution purposes.
So how recent or current was that data?
Can we get a lot of more questions to the end, please?
Yes. No. I'll
definitely come back to your questions.
See, from technology point of view, the only thing I can add is that the Election Commission did a great job. The fact that, you know, they've been able to computerize their records across the country is something which is really commendable. The fact that people can enroll online and also get divisions or transfers, etc. done is something which technology adaptation by a government department is a very phenomenal thing. But for, you know, small errors of, you know, 0.1% or 0.2% is what the EC does. Overall data is something which is very, very, you know, accurate and was able to be. The only thing is the people did not know how to use it, because most of us are not very familiar to search for our thing, because there's a part number, there's a serial number and all those things. Maybe in that aspect of technology where the voters need to be made aware as to how to trace out their name and addresses from, or whether they are there in the voter list, that is something that the people will have to get adapted to technology that much more faster to be able to make best utility out of it.
For that, I think they had a moment.
They did set up SMS, SMS campaign was there. They did set up, but you know, still the response was not very good, because, you know, despite that, people complained on the last day, and that was something which
SMS was not popularized as much as the internet portal was.
Internet portal was
quite popularized.
Their technology adoption was, you know, really very good. And your question as to, you know, how recent it was, between October and the last day of the final list, there were three revisions that happened in the span of 4 months. And that's something which, you know, it was that current.
Okay, let's move on to the next question, which is around how did when you applied technology to your campaigns, how did you leverage different locations that these teams spread across, and what sort of teams were involved behind these campaigns? Could you first enlighten me?
So, you know, for us, you know, we were in the Bangalore, the Bombay, and the Gandhinagar, obviously, because Modi operates from Gandhinagar. So, you know, we, the teams we had here, and we also had a team in Delhi, but each of us were working on separate, you know, the parts of the project. And so, for example, to do the content, the creativity was happening over here. The, you know, the language, the campaigning, the creatives was, it was all happening over here. The, you know, the volunteer actually backend was happening from Gandhinagar, because he was involved actually about what had to be done, what had to be changed. So it's like this, you know, we were there in few locations, and every week we used to be interacting about, you know, what things, you know, had to be to thought up and for change.
Would you like to add?
Yeah, location-wise, I mean, given that it's one campaign, I mean, we were all sort of located right in Bangalore South. Our campaign office was in Jayanagar, near Ashoka Pillar. I could that people would be familiar with the area. We had a number of teams, though. I mean, just to hit upon the the composition of a campaign team. They were rough. I mean, we had a dedicated technology team doing all the things that we talked about. But we had a legal and compliance team because the Election Commission has very strict reporting guidelines for campaign expenses, finances, and all that. We had a communications team, following the news and the media every day and posting updates on our social media handles, on our website, in our press releases. We had over and above that, we had a field team which would coordinate all our volunteer efforts and political coordination to coordinate with the offices of various leaders and such. And sort of all these teams use technology in different ways, but that's about all I have to say on this.
I keep hearing about the teams often. Can I get a quick sense of what is the strength of the team that is involved?
Yeah, I know it's my follow-up question. So his question is, what were the kind of teams used in the national campaign?
Yeah, the people who are working the whole time, between four cities could be about 100. But if you include the volunteers, which I didn't mention, who are in every part of the thing, I'm not sure it's 20,000 or whatever.
So what did the volunteers do? What were they charged with? From a technology side?
See, few people were involved in the door-to-door, say for example, because from the platform, people would come to know what is the message which had to be informed when they go on door-to-door. So that's some small jobs. There are so many. We had some people who were scanning all the websites to see if anything was positive, the spamming, the negative, because he's a man where the number of things go everywhere. So like that, there are so many things which are done.
What would have been the size of your team?
Just in a sense. Our team, I would say like the campaign team per se, not counting volunteers and party workers and such, was about 40 people. Lot of them were sort of freelancers. It's not like 40 full-timers, and within the 40 people in the campaign team itself, some of them were volunteers, some of them were full-time, some of them were part-time. And sort of roles kind of, depending on the life cycle of the campaign, certain roles, like communication becomes very important, messaging becomes very important in the last 2 weeks or 4 weeks, but technology is more important sort of in the planning stage, But about 40 years.
When you spoke earlier, you touched upon some of what I would call the use cases of where technology was applied. Could you dwell a little more? You talked about knowing where to go and what calls to answer and all things like that. Could you dwell on more use cases where you use technology?
Yeah, exactly.
Internally, because what the audience sees is typically as a voter, what they see is information, bites of things like that. Right? But if you look at it behind the veil in terms of how you guys use it for your the mechanics of how you went about reaching the various different things you just touched upon. What are the different use cases you used for internally, which is not very obvious to somebody else?
Okay, so internally I would say that the preparation that we had to do would probably not be visible right outside. Is for example, we went with a message on Bangalore. How did we come to it? So of course the starting point of everything in an election is the voter list. So as someone raised the question, you start with the voter list, extract it, understand the demographics, gender composition, area-wise composition, how many votes come from which area, so on and so forth. And from there on, we sort of work towards, this is where sort of technology, you start going away from pure technology, you have to meet with people, finally they're voters, So what were the different groups of voters? There is young people, old people, people, working professionals, housewives, retired. So broadly 10 to 12 classes of people, then we actually conducted focus groups with them. We brought all the data back in from qualitative research, quantitative research, and sort of put that all together and then took a call on how to come up with our campaign's message, the plank on which the campaign would run. So this is, for example, one of the things, that we did. I should say that we ended up using very traditional, off-the-shelf, in fact, everything was open source that we used in terms of tools. So a lot of it you know, Excel was good enough.
Before we get to tools, I just want to focus on
that's what you want.
I come to tools.
Yes. No, that's cool.
Any other use cases come to you?
I know, I mean, for internal, like you suggest, this is what it is.
Would you like to throw some light in terms of what all you folks use?
No, I think afterwards, I mean, the examples I want to give is, I would say mainly in terms of, you know, the social media. So, you want me to go with that now?
More in terms of how, what are the things that you use for internet? Either which voters to go after, or get to the internal resources. I think that's the kind of internal use case.
And also, to that, did you use any other data? Not only the ECI provided data, did you use anything else? The confidence targeting the particular.
Yeah. So, see, in our case, you know, one big advantage we had was because we were, you know, collecting the data on the platform. But how do we spread the information or the fact that, you know, that we have a platform? The best way was Mr. Modi. He used to go on the talks, the TV, and say that if you want to work for me, if you want to help me, log on to the portal, and you could see the spike in the thing. And from that, we should get a lot of data. So once you get, you know, say about 100 people who you register, from that 100, another 100, 100, 100, like that it became data. And from that, we actually built up.
What do you want to add anything to that?
See, as far as talking from media point of view, they're not much, but whatever little bit I know of app used cloud telephony in a big way. That was something which was a tool that they had used for reaching out in Delhi elections, because I followed that election pretty closely, and even here, that they were able to get volunteers to work out on a cloud telephony system, which they used very well to be able to reach out. So whenever you took membership, or you know that missed call campaigns that they had, those were their basic information gathering systems as to who could be a potential voter, and that was something that they had done a good homework on to be able to get those missed calls. So you know, free memberships for nothing else but to be able to get back to people in time. I'm sure many of you also did give those missed calls over here and were able to, like, you know, later on maybe contribute, because as far as Varanasi campaign is concerned, even I had volunteered for that and was able to make about 40 to 50 calls from here to people in so this is something which did help in getting resources on the ground. So while they had limited people, and then again volunteers, many of them were in control or not, I'm not sure. But this is something which, what little bit I know of our talking on their behalf, I can just say that cloud telephony is something which did work for them.
In fact, to add to that, we used telephony a fair bit, cloud telephony, and even more traditional, but maybe we'll touch upon that.
Yeah, now that we're diving into technology anyway, let's talk about
the kind of... Can I just answer the specific question about, you know, using other data sources? In fact, we actually used a fair amount of data sources apart from what's available on the EC website. So apart from electoral data, we use data on how media is consumed. So, you know, what languages, you know, what newspapers, what TV channels. So there's a readership survey that you can get. So we superimpose that on our electoral data. We also superimpose the income data that was available. We use census data and bunch of stuff that we collected on the ground from our own surveys or teams, you know, cameras. So the whole point was to bring everything onto a common platform and then ask specific questions and go on. So it was incredibly useful to be able to do such an exercise, and we created a tool called Hawkeye, which we've talked about a little bit in the campaign as well, where you could actually just pick, you know, on a map, or you could pick any location in Bangalore South, and all of this data, electoral data, basically a mashup of all this stuff. Also budgets, that what the local government has spent on, you know, various things, whatever was available in the public domain, create a mashup of all of this and use that to familiarize ourselves with the
process.
We have to buy some map data, but that's about it.
Simple
data is not
available. No, but actually in the market, you know, you will get many phone calls. We have the phone numbers of everybody in Bangalore, everybody.
The reason
we didn't buy any of those.
Since you spoke about cloud telephony,
yeah.
My landline number, yeah. I'm not there, you know. This is my personal,
yeah.
No one knows my landline number.
Yeah.
And I got automated phone calls from Nilekani's campaign.
Yeah.
I did not know that was
from the BSNL phone book.
Yeah, so that that is not public data, right?
It's public data.
Okay, follow the directory.
I have done CT now, so that was
not easy. I think perhaps I was traveling.
This is Hawkeye to open us.
This is Hawkeye to open to the public.
Sorry?
Hawkeye. We are going to launch, we are repackaging it and we'll be launching it shortly for public use.
So how much of data did you have to generate and how much of data was available to you?
I would say the amount of information was there, was already there a lot from the EC website. The real work started after that because it had to be processed, you know, it had to be put into various buckets. So I think the work was there more.
I think the best data that you get in EC is about ward level data of
so both level and
ward level. Beyond that, how as I said, how can it be generated gender-wise and that?
No, it's available from, in fact, if you look at the booth, there's a book for every booth, that'll tell you how many men, how many women, how many total.
Past voting trends would not be available at that.
Those are available.
They're still on there.
No, as in about
gender-wise, but what
you get. Booth level is available.
Both polling percentages can be got.
Can be got.
It shows you as to how the tendency of voters in that particular area.
So gender-wise, you have to get by doing surveys or whatever.
Because when we launch Pledge to Vote, we use this data for doing specific campaigns in those particular areas. Like Koramangala has got one of the worst track records in the world. And we found that even in this entire thing, the total polling was only 39.8% there. So you know, it shows that a lot more work needs to be done to actually look at it.
I just want to ask Mahesh, any other data sources, e-customer data sources, any other do you want to talk much about? In addition to what they mentioned.
I mean, you had the actual ones, but other than that, as I told, you know, once the people know that you are involved in the campaign, you get a lot of phone calls. I'm having this data, I'm having that data. But there is no way to verify what you're about to buy is good. So we were not, because you don't know whom you're actually calling.
Actually, it's mostly scam artists.
Yeah, we don't know. So we did not buy a single one from outside.
In fact, we did not buy any data that, you know, all these, we got various calls also. Okay.
Yeah.
5,000 rupees mein ye CD
okay. Yeah, yeah. Actually speaking, it's not very expensive. You know, for the entire city, they'll give for 5,000 bucks. So all those things are there. But one good source of, you know, data actually, I would say, is Facebook. Because almost every Indian who's on the internet, who's, you know, like actually wasting their time or whatever, is actually on Facebook. Okay, so, but that quality of the data there is very good. You know, because you know the gender, the age group and all of that. So that, I think when he comes into the thing, I can explain what few things what we did and it worked very well for us.
I'm consciously extending this segment because it sets the tone for the others and it kind of creates a platform for the rest of the discussion. I just wanted to bring another dimension into the discussion, which is languages. And you all talked about different sources of data and things of that. So obviously we have nation where people speak so many different languages. There's also the urban-rural divide and where there are so many languages to kind of deal with, right? At least each state has a major language. So how do you guys decide what languages to focus on? Obviously you had limited resources, you couldn't have thrown money everywhere. And which all languages did you focus on? I just like to, I'm sure that's a topic of interest for you as well, Mahesh, if you want to take it.
So, I mean, you know, it is a no-brainer that in the Hindi was the most important one because more than half of India, half of the voter list is, you know, from the
Hindi-speaking.
Yeah, Hindi-speaking thing. That is one. But when we made the creatives for the campaign, which went across the websites, we did in all the languages. You know, the South Indian. You name the language, we made sure. So all the targeted which we had the campaign, example the campaigns which went to Maharashtra, they were in English and Marathi, for example. And we saw that the response of the banners in the languages, it was the higher than the traditional ones. Okay. And in Modi's blog, all the articles were translated to some, I think, approximately 17 or so, you know, like all the languages. Every article was there. So I would say Hindi, your Tamil, your Kannada, and all that. I think the response was good.
So what you're saying is the blogs were translated in 17 languages.
Yeah, I mean I don't have the exact, but it was very high. Yeah.
17 or thereabouts.
Yeah, thereabouts.
What about the website itself?
So
was the 17 language thing across channels, as in mobile, website, banner ads, or was it just for some of the channels?
No, no. His blog, it's in all languages. So whether the people are using his app or the browsing on the phone, you were able to read it in all the languages. So your campaign portal, to a large extent, it was in English, to a very large extent, and to some extent in Hindi. Our goal was to do in all the languages, but the amount of work we had for English alone was very high. We had, as you know, like close to say 500 rallies, if I'm right. So for each rally, the amount of work we had was extremely high, which very few people were knew, because before every rally we used to do the homework of what are the important issues he had to actually speak about, and as as he speaks, the reactions from the media were being actually posted, and after the rally for about a half a day we would go and from AFP, Twitter, etc., we would be gathering. So by the end of the day, for each rally he wanted to see the report. So when he flies, so he wanted to see the report for each rally. So that itself was exhaustive work, and to sit and do that in 15 languages, we didn't have the bandwidth.
It's increasingly difficult. So
he always wanted to know, if not for every rally, but say if he goes to a particular a constituency, he wanted to know that what do people from there want? What are the local things which has to be talked? Of course, everywhere we can talk about the road, water,
so
and all.
So done through field volunteers?
No, because of the platform we had, we have the volunteers. So they were giving us the feedback, and that we would actually compile and send it to them. We would have it in the buckets. We would not send him the raw data. We would say, so many people are talking about this. So he wanted only those important points.
How would you leverage the raw data and the data?
Yeah, he wants to
talk
about
that in another section. So would you like to throw light on how the Nilekani campaign moves language and different channels that we use, different languages we use,
so we used one India and
Kannada. We did use one India and Kannada actually. So that was definitely one of the very key. Actually, Kannada was a very important language for us. Being in just Bangalore South, it was Kannada and English. A very small fraction of the people are Hindi speaking, but they also either speak at least Kannada or English. So we were able to get away with these two. So on the phone, we did Kannada and English. On the website, we had all the basic content was English, Kannada both, but the blogs, for example, were English only. And this was just based from the observation, looking at the browser settings that people are coming from. We are seeing people with language settings for English. So,
in hindsight, we didn't turn it up for the next campaign. Wouldn't most people not know how to change the browser settings anyway?
So exactly. If I can add one information about
very good indicator.
Well, but as long as they're able to consume our content, we were kind of important blog posts, important press releases, for example, we did in English and Kannada. More of the internet stuff was English, because Facebook, you can't really do a Kannada Facebook. You can put some content
in action. How many in your team knew Kannada?
We had about half.
Actually, I would be a little surprised that your candidate is anyway an IT man. You never reach out to the IT audience. I thought you'd use Kannada as a very focused technology campaign. Because you would reach out to the audience who normally may not have easy access to.
So that audience exactly is not the one that is on your blog, right? For example, that audience is the one you reach out through a phone call or through a speech or through a padyatra. And there, the entire interface was in Kannada. Entire language of the campaign was Kannada.
So one thing I can say for us, what was good, I'm going to say for us, for One India, was for every roadshow which he had, know, we used to get the photos and the article in English and also in the Kannada. So it became very easy for us to be the publishing, you know, the content. Everybody else, if at all they sent, it was very rare. Because, you know, very few of the politicians, they thought internet was very important for spreading, you know, the news. But from there, we got it in a very clean way where we were able to just, you know, your copy and actually paste. That was good for us.
Yeah. I should add that, for example, banner ads on Kannada website, we did Kannada.
Yeah. And it did well.
Yeah. We got very high click rates on those. But putting a Kannada ad in an English paper in Bangalore, we tried all these A-B testing.
Given that this is a session running run up to a larger event coming up on big data, so you guys talked about different sources of data and things like that and mishmash and etc. What sort of real analytics and big data technology do you use for top and would you like to throw some back on it?
Would you call MySQL a big data?
I believe that in your interpretation, because I don't want to get into technology, I want to get more into how you see.
Like I was saying earlier, we use very off-the-shelf commodity because a campaign is, you know, such a short time and you don't want to overbuild or over-engineer, you know, unless you absolutely need something. I can imagine if you were doing something all India, like, you know, these guys were doing, maybe, you know, there may be some role for big data and, you know, some cutting-edge tools. But for us, you know, MySQL and basic SQL pretty much served the purpose.
I mean, you will agree that in India, this entire thing was done for the first time. Okay, and you know, we have got, you know, so many of the, you know, one thing about this campaign I learned is you get so many calls and emails for with the free advice. You get a lot of free advice. You know, I am an expert in this. You should do this. You should do that. I told, you know, we have so many things to do. Ideas within the team itself. We have. Half of them are not actually practical to begin with. Okay, but we'll be very happy if you can come and, you know, work for one day and implement few things. When the moment you ask somebody to come and implement, they're all gone. Okay, there's nobody there, you know. So it was like that. So we did not say, you know, okay, directly use all these, the, you know, these keywords, the big data, this and that. But we use the tools, the commercial tools like the SAP or, your Trackix is one tool which we use for, you know, social media. So all those tools what we used, they were using actually behind. Then I'm sure they used the big data because even, you know, the tools we used, they were very impressed with the amount of the data they were able to get for some more. Because the amount of, every time he goes for a rally, the number of tweets and FB, it goes so high that it went to a state that we had to wait for 24 hours to get the actual, you know, the data. It was not real time. Even though when we went for these tools, they told it is, you know, so real time, this, that. But when they saw the amount of data which is coming in, so all those things, you know.
Alright, this has been an interesting segment as far as I go. To kind of close it off, I just have a question for the panel. We talked about all these exciting stuff on technology that you guys did within and also sort of gave a window of it to the potential voter. But the fundamental thing, if you ask me, was how did you connect all these interesting findings to the grassroots level guy who's knocking at the door to say hello to a voter? So how did you, and most of them, I guess, are not really technology savvy in any city if you look at it. They're just people who knock at the doors and talk to somebody and talk about their candidate or their party or whatever. So how did you guys connect all these fancy tools and conclusions and thereof to the average guy who's actually the volunteer from the party to sort of knock doors? And how did that connect happen? And how did you approach it as well?
You know, for us, what happened is for in each of these constituencies, you know, we had a representative who was handling all the offline volunteers. So our contact was only with them. I mean, there's no way, and we don't have the expertise, you know, we especially need to be speaking to the offline guys on what they should do, how they should do the door, because that's not our right? Our expertise was to gather the information from the platform, from the thing about, you know, what are the real issues which you need to go and talk. So that is the package which we were sending to the key people, and who were like actually your passing was on to the offline world.
Okay. What was your experience?
Yeah, what we did was, so we had two things, in fact, for specifically for people who knocked on doors. So we actually had a volunteer campaign, where people would come in. In fact, this was also a screening tool, as Mahesh referred to, that moment new guy would come, we'd say, okay, first go and spend a day knocking doors. And, anyone who's not serious usually disappears on that. So we had a website that was mobile optimized, so you could use it through the browser. So for people who were sort of proficient in using a smartphone with their data access, so they would go and record their conversations at the doorstep itself. But for those who could not, they would go with paper. In fact, they'd just get a sheet saying, okay, this, cover these streets, and then they would make their notings on it and bring it back, and then some other volunteers would actually sort of type it in, enter it into the system. So it was essential to gather data from everyone, but it was not a must that, okay, to volunteer for the campaign, you must own a smartphone and know how to operate technology.
Someone knocking at the door and use an app. Okay.
We did. That's what I said. So there were some volunteers who were capable of doing that, and then there were some who not. So we accommodated both sides.
One thing that I want to add, sure, usage of technology is concerned, is when the campaign started, especially there was an overdrive with the BJP on the social media and other aspects, there was a lot of skepticism whether this generation, the internet generation, would go out and vote. That's a big question mark that was there in everybody's mind. But by the time the election started and we had the second, third phase, and we saw the higher polling, that is the time, I'm sure BJP also understood at that time, that it was working for them. That's the reason why we saw an overdrive in the last 3-4 phases, where everybody suddenly was waking up to this. And the overall growth in polling that we've seen across the country, about 10%, clearly has shown that technology has worked. And that's something that we must credit the efforts of all these people who have used technology, that they were able to at least get people to go out and vote. And this is something which clearly showed that this generation of internet users, because many old-time politicians that we met at that time who said, "Are ye sab vote dalne wale nahi hain," typical attitude that these people are not going to come out, don't even waste time on the internet. That was the kind of impression. But clearly these elections have shown that technology and social media can be used effectively, and this is something that the political parties who have not used it till now will have to use it, and also the voters will have to understand that this is the most cost-effective way to communicate. And that's something which is a very important aspect of this, that it's most cost-effective. Printing a pamphlet, going out over there is very, very tough. But, sending out an email, sending out messages, this is something which technology has shown that campaigns can be done using the internet and other social media sites in a very effective way.
So it is scalable.
Scalable.
So only that's the winning part. That's the winning part.
One last comment before we throw open for questions. So I don't want to know if anybody in the audience saw, the folks who were there next to the polling booths, right? They are the guys who actually work the polling agents, as they call it, or whatever. So I didn't see too many of them use any either laptop or any form of data, which is paper, the usual as always. Do you see that changing sometime?
Is that Yeah.
They were tabs.
I see.
There were tabs, there were laptops. I can tell you specifically in our campaign, this is very interesting actually. I don't know if you want to share the story right now or from the last day. So, last day is what we call, the last week of the campaign is typically referred to as the get out of the vote, GOTV part of the campaign. And especially on the last day, all of you here, or most of you here would have voted, right? So there's a table that the party set up, and then you go there and you look yourself up, and there's some people
trying to do a quick straw poll. How many of you voted here? Raise your hand. 60%.
So there's this frantic activity of looking up, and then, there are so many people who are at the wrong booths, and all kinds of mayhem is breaking loose. What we had was the day before the campaign, we developed a very simple app, which was just a look up, punch in, because everyone comes with a voter ID on the last day. So you don't have to do like some name and age and address mishmash to find the person. Otherwise, with common names in India, it's very impossible to find people. But So with the voter ID, we could look up a voter. We had a small, again, web-enabled app. Here I would say website, but... what we did was all the volunteers that we had. So we had about 200 to 300 volunteers that were manning about 300 booths, along with the party workers, and they all had this access to this website. And at the day started, we had zero hits on this thing. We were not even sure, you know. We had the same, are these party workers, you know, who are what, you know. In fact, to the point that you were like told, I mean, you guys are all some, you know, silly fellows, you don't know ground reality, all that. Started out the day with zero hits. Within the first hour, queues were building up, and these smartphone-enabled volunteers were in high demand. Oh, that you can actually look up someone, and the case, right, where, you know, you may have only the book for your own booth, but you may not know if the person is the wrong booth, where do you send him? So now you say, oh, this is the booth, you have to go to the write a check and send him out. By afternoon, we were sort of at hundreds of hits every minute, and thousands of users, and the word just spread virally, I mean, in the sense that amongst the tables, because we had no way to communicate to these tables that there is this thing. I mean, it was just whatever word spread around in the field, and we saw this S-curve, and it was quite nice. We saw thousands of voters that, you know, got help who were otherwise not voted. Actually, tens of thousands. So, and that, you know, there was one lady who was voting for AAP, actually. She was at an AAP table, and she was frantically, like, she was getting upset that, you know, why is my name not on the list? And then one of our volunteers walked over, and she was like, you know, what's your voter ID? And, you know, looked it up. And her comment was, my vote is no longer for AAP, but it's for AAP. So that summed it up kind of nicely for us. But, so I do think that actually, you know, we discredit this technology a little too much, saying that grassroots, I mean, like, you know, Vijay, you almost talked about this internet-enabled youth, right? I mean, just to put the numbers in perspective, 20% of the people are, at least across India, are online, 20 to 25%. And the winning margin in a typical campaign, I mean, not in a wave election like this, but is 5%, 3%. So why would you, you know, discredit anything?
Thank you. That was an interesting perspective you shared.
Right.
I just sum this up and then I throw it over to you guys, right? So this is an interesting segment. We primarily covered, you know, how did parties approach it at multiple levels, the central, state, cabinet level. How did they approach strategies? How did they apply different technologies? How did they look at language, and how do they connect the, what do they do within, behind the veil, and what do they do in front, the front parts going to come in the next segment. And I think the rural and the urban aspect also got touched upon, the team sizes, etc. So I hope you found this segment interesting. We'll pause here and limit questions only to teams around this this segment. So we'll come to other questions around other segments actually. Go ahead. You like to be loud or I'll repeat your question.
I can't hear
you. We can't hear you. You like to be much louder? So how they yes, I got a question. So let me replay your question to make sure I understood. So your question is looking at a grassroots level worker, how can you push technology to them or get them to use it better? Like, what ideas you have around that, the panelizing. So just to make sure, I think Mr. Mahesh touched upon how they had a conduit through which they work with the non-skill, rather non-tech workers.
Yeah.
And I think he talked about how they, some of them had apps, which were sort of the savvy ones actually had apps to make non-tech roles.
Yeah.
So his question is, how would you go about in future campaigns, perhaps enable the otherwise not tech savvy the volunteers and workers. Who's knocking at the doors? Is there any ideas around that?
No, so see, we already had an app too. We also had an app, which, you know, so any volunteer who had a smartphone was able to use it. Because, as you told in the, I mean, I would not say only in the heartland, everywhere, you do have the, the majority of people who are the traditional workers, I would say, who have been there in the party for a long time. I don't know if they had it or not. So, to send the information to them, we had the contacts in each of the areas. So, from us, information is to go to them, and from them, it used to spread. So, in the, I would say, the next 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, I'm pretty sure the usage of the smartphone would be, I mean, I think almost everybody who has a phone, it would be that. So I think it will only be good. But I would say for, as I told you, in India, for the first time it has been used, all of what we did. For the first time, I think the performance was actually good.
I agree.
Yeah.
It was the first campaign.
Yeah, we are biased, obviously. We think we did a good job.
By design, the panel
is
biased. Does that answer your question?
So addressing our all these things is a function of our tool, which is the smartphone. As the smartphone increases, you see it can use quite a few.
But you know, like I was saying, right, it doesn't have to be technology at the front end, right? I mean, there will be younger party workers who are comfortable using technology and a smartphone. But you may have, for example, you may have women who are not comfortable using it in certain parts of the country, or you may have older people, and you know, if you you don't want to leave out any potential party worker or volunteer base, so you have to always have this, you know, non-technology front end. And there is value to it also, right? I mean, how would you like it if someone came to your door and is constantly fiddling on your phone while talking to you on the phone? It's just, you know, nicer to come, you know, take some notes, and then someone else sort of enters it in. I mean, there are pros and cons to both, and I think we're not going to be at either extreme for like long time to come.
So my take is that, you know, I think they articulated very nicely how there's a lot more work to be done even behind the way. Right? I mean, he talked about the challenge of how it was so difficult to keep pace with each of those languages talks, and that itself was a huge thing. And we talked about how 17 languages was a huge challenge in the first place, and the other gentleman talked about how two languages itself was a challenge. So from that point of view, there's a lot more work to be done behind the scenes as well. And if they could manage with a liaison point who would in turn communicate to others, at least you get the job done. But you're not trying to solve the larger problem of getting the grassroots level worker to become tech savvy. This is a much bigger problem.
To some extent, you know, the grassroots level workers have also got adaptation. I will give you a case of general assembly constituency where the BJP gave out smartphones to every booth level worker who went door to door in the last 3 days to check out whether the voter was in town or not. And this is basically just a rough check that was done. And you know, the application was very simple. It started out with Narendra Modi's photo, and then it went on to Vijay Kumar's photo, and then when you swipe the ward corporator's photo, and then from there it would, you know, get to the street number, address, etc. Number of voters over there, available, not available. By just pressing those buttons over there, the booth level worker was able to actually do an attendance check 3 days before to find out how many people were there, how many people were not there, to be able to get a fair idea of, you know, what it was. So this is something which is going to get only simpler, and I'm sure political parties realize that, you know, cumbersome data which otherwise, you know, they had to carry sheets, reams and reams of paper to take and mark and somebody to read, was difficult. Here at end of it, somebody would say that in my booth 730 votes, out of which 570 people are in town, 270 people are not there. So don't expect, you know, more than this polling can. So this is something which, you know, people will adapt, and I'm sure with, you know, tech savvy people like them will be heading campaigns in the future also. They will be able to teach a lot more campaigns.
So you already got two interesting use cases. One to determine whether they were in town or not, and the other one to help a voter find the polling booth using the voter ID. You've got two specific use cases, pretty much. Okay. So, any other questions, one or two, before we move on to the next segment?
Thank you so much, Mr. Mahesh. You said you were collecting data from Facebook, Twitter. So exactly what kind of data?
That's for next segment. Yeah, we'll hold that question.
One small question. Costing. Briefly, the panelists touched about it.
So can you please elaborate on how this cost, there are limits to in per candidate limits, etc. So how will this technology part of the cost put into candidate this one, and how is it really costing calculated?
Interesting question. I'll let the panelists give that take.
No, according to me, it is actually back-end work.
Yeah, but back-end work doesn't count as a...
It is not, right?
It's only a voter party.
No, it's not a party. It is a GDR collecting the information from everywhere, doing something, and informing the relevant, actually, people, the candidate, the party chiefs, or whatever. So that is okay. But if you go, I mean, see, we are not included in the holdings and all that. We are not part of that.
The way campaign finance is regulated is that, you know, they're trying to sort of regulate the interface between the, whatever, the politician and the voter to avoid any kind of, you know, bad stuff that goes on at that interface. But it does not include sort of, for example, I mean, the work that you do before, you know,
nomination.
Before nomination, right?
It happens before nomination level.
Or back-end work, for example, you know. So
all this homework is generally done much before, you know, when he files nomination, so it never gets late for
that. It's like months before, right? I mean, campaigns start.
So what is the costing that you had to report to, say, the election commission?
Our costing is public information. I mean, I was not the compliance person in the team, but there is a 70 lakh limit on every
call. I guess we touched on the fringes of it, but I think let's get back to technology.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. So let's move on to let's move on to the next segment. I'm sort of promoting social media, because I don't want to hold it to the end, because it's something that many of you may have experienced yourself. So this segment's about how do parties specifically use social media in their campaigns. And this is around Twitter and Facebook and, you know, WhatsApp and YouTube, and any other that you think that would be useful. So how did the parties use that? And let's get started with the first opening round to just set the context of what all we are looking for. So do you want to start from that end for a second?
Sure. So we made extensive use. I mean, we talked about, so we had the website and our blog. That was, you know, one primary thing. Facebook was, you know, probably as important or more important, actually I would say more important than our website because of the social aspect of it. The third important in our this thing was Twitter. So for on Facebook, we were almost touching 400,000 people who had liked our page, which means any update posted would, you know, I think Facebook propagates it to 20% of your like universe every time you send. So maybe your 7 or 10 posts, it would reach out to all of them. So 400,000 people is a large number for us. And on Twitter, we had 100,000 people following us sort of, you know, when the campaign was coming to a close. And sort of with the way the properties kind of played out was that on Twitter, it was almost as if you were following the campaign, like you were following Nandan Nilekani in real time. Like, you know, we had a person who was always there with a smartphone tweeting, you know, live, you know, photos, you know, tweets and such. Facebook would not be as live for us, but it, you know, you'd see a collage of pictures and you'd get a good sense. But it was also where our, you know, sort of our positions and various other things were discussed. Lot more lively discussion, if you can call like reader participation, that happened on Facebook for us. So that was, these were the essential things. We also, I think, were the only campaign which had a LinkedIn profile, but I don't think it got very widely used.
What about YouTube? Yeah,
so
WhatsApp.
Yeah, so actually, on YouTube, we had, you know, we regularly posted videos, and some of them, some of these earlier part of the campaign, we got very large number of hits on many of our YouTube videos. WhatsApp, interestingly, I mean, some campaigns, I don't know how they managed to do this, but people were able to send WhatsApp messages through, and I don't know of a public API to WhatsApp, so we sort of stayed clear of trying to find some ways around that.
Basically, it was human robots.
Yeah, that's it.
WhatsApp messaging.
I saw some hacked stuff also at some point, but I don't know who did it, how, and where, and why. But actually, the more interesting use for WhatsApp for us was internal use. So our entire volunteer networks actually sort of self-organize themselves over WhatsApp, information sharing, pictures, you know, live from the field within the campaign team. So I think by the end of the campaign, we're almost at some 20, 30 WhatsApp groups, and my phone battery was just dying, like, you know, because of WhatsApp.
Right, that's interesting.
So do you want to share the perspective on?
Sure. So the, you know, the way we use in this entire campaign, I think most of you will agree that his presence on AFB and all that was actually humongous. And he actually understood the power of it, and he asked us that, you know, we should be posting rather on his page, because he was going to Pune in the last, I think, September to, you know, a college called, you know, Ferguson's College, where he was going to talk. So, you know, very few will agree or not. No, he has that, you know, the vision. He caught up and told that, informed the team there, obviously, that, you know, how about we ask on his FB page to tell that I'm going to be coming to Pune, okay, you know, or what are the issues you have and what are the things you want me to talk about. And I think we had like at least, you know, 50,000 responses. 50,000. Of course, there are many you will ignore. They'll say, you know, hello sir, how are you, this thing, that thing. So for us, it said we have to get all those, and you know, you have to filter it out, you know, removing, you know, all those things. But we did get some quality, you know, things over there, which, you know, which went to him. So I would say the concept of a crowdsourcing for a political campaign on the internet was actually started by him. And for us, yeah, the, you know, we had huge the success on AFB, Twitter, on YouTube. It is all, you know, his actually speeches. Not everybody is able to watch all the rallies live, so they go home or go later, you know, and they watch it. The highest engagement we got was obviously from Facebook. The Facebook app, which we, you know, we made, I think, like in the month of March or February or March. The engagement we got there was, you know, phenomenal. That is something we learned, I think, a bit late. I wish we had experimented, you know, this, long ago. And the one which I think very few used, and I think we use a lot, is actually G+. The G+ grew so well, it was, in the end, you know, bigger than the Twitter followers. Okay, why we did not get a whole lot of, you know, referral from the G+, but the number of people who are interacting after each post, the liking, the plus ones, and the commenting on that page was very high. On the Twitter, I feel the engagement is not very good. Many people are, you know, seeing the tweet, but the number of people who are giving the quality responses, not a whole lot, but it is very high on Facebook.
Are you calling the opponent also?
No.
You are calling the Modi, but are you calling the opponent also? No. Because you are competitors, are you calling those there also on Facebook or Twitter?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we are, but he is so far ahead. No, no, like, see the number of followers.
Let's get it.
No, no, the number of followers he has is 17 million. I mean, I don't know, I forgot the number.
No, I think let's go back to this question. And this question is not about a candidate. This question was about, did your campaign follow competition?
Yes.
Let's not de-utilize the individual.
No, because initially we had to, and that's what I'm telling. But when the gap becomes huge, okay, I mean, you know, there is not a much you're able to compare. There's not, and initially when we started the work, you know, we had a, you know, this, we were wondering on how can we increase his following. And we did all this, you know, you draw this graph, that graph, and then let's follow this thing. And he goes once and he talks on the TV, he on his own is getting so many new likes. So we completely said we'll not do anything for getting new fans for him. Because he himself is getting.
This question is not about getting more followers.
This question is another campaign.
What did other candidates say on their Twitter handles or their Facebook?
Oh, surely.
Why I find it difficult to buy your point of view is because of the fact when there was so much attention to you having volunteers trying to make sense of what at the grassroots level were the issues, I'd be very surprised if you said you didn't pay attention to what another candidate was saying on Twitter handle or on Facebook or on their talks.
No, but you see,
but obviously, what I would think you do that first and you will get a grassroots.
No, no, what we were trying to read is what the entire ecosystem was talking. See, the entire ecosystem was huge where you get the... See, if you follow only one or two candidates, the amount of the data you get from them is not a whole lot. But if you are looking into the entire ecosystem, the amount of the thing you get, feedback data, is a lot more, out of which you are able to make sense. I'm not saying by any means that we were not looking at the competition at all, or we were ignoring the competition. But the number of updates that were happening on FB pages were very few of the candidates were, you know, the savvy or something who were actually doing.
Okay, so bring the discussion back to the...
Just to answer the same question.
See, as far as social media is concerned, especially Facebook, Twitter, it started off very well and brought about a lot of excitement. Given from the Delhi elections, I would want to take where it was used very effectively initially, that people suddenly saw this, and in the level of involvement of the middle class, the Indian middle class, with the political parties did increase initially. But as the campaign progressed over the last couple of weeks, we saw the animosity became very, very harsh. And this is something which certainly is something which, you know, people felt that it was in bad taste, because it kind of jokes or, you know, the images that were being circulated around on FB or Twitter or
WhatsApp.
So this is something which, you know, created a lot of bad blood in terms of thing. And that's something where there has to be some kind of regulation, I feel, in the future, where, you know, this kind of spoofs that were made or, you know, those irrespective of political parties has to be avoided. Because if a campaign, there is a certain decorum, it would be more appreciable. But unfortunately, we saw that the free-for-all kind of a campaign where, you know, fun was made, digs were taken, and, you know, that's something which social media certainly did not give, you know, that kind of grace to the campaign.
So, sir, you're a member on the panel.
Yes, sir.
I would probably ask your opinion on how do you see, especially the election commission or other authorities, have a handle on this sort of chat, right? I mean, obviously, different things are happening. Mm-hmm. So, how did you think that they can have?
See, certainly this is something which needs to be, you know, because it is not just, you know, making fun, also misinformation campaign, that was something which social media went berserk on that, where we saw a lot of wrong information was shared about questions, distorted images of Muzaffarnagar, you know, those kind of things which were spread, you know, like wildfire, which only created, you know, a lot more polarization or a lot more hatred amongst people. So that's where the election commission will now have to come in and, you know, actually control. Kapil Sibal had made reference to this in February, but, you know, that he was bulldozed by the media in terms of, you know, how can you regulate the social media and all that kind of thing.
Don't you think satire is a very capable channel for effective propaganda?
Satire and wrong information.
Satire and wrong information
are different to the earlier part of the
comment. Spoofs is different. No, but what happened? Distorted images of Muzaffarnagar.
No, the first part that you mentioned, I was just, you know, echoing the satire.
Yeah.
First part of the thing, I feel satire is kind of...
Satire did a good thing in terms of, you know, just making fun of someone was fine. You know, when it makes you register, and, you know, the one plus point of the social media was that, let's say, if there's a joke about Rahul Gandhi or if there was a joke about Modi, you have the tendency of sharing it with friends. So it had a multiplier effect. If you saw any satire on television, and then mainstream media, or you saw a cartoon or newspaper, you cannot share it with someone. You can read it, enjoy it, and leave it. But if I get a cartoon on my phone, I have the tendency that, you know, at least let my friends know it. So that one advantage did work for the BJP, because, you know, they were very creative in terms of, you know, having the first mover advantage to be able to spread those kind of things. But later on, you know,
you know, spread is a very evil word.
It's not a serious question. See, everybody knows Mr. Modi is a spring doctor's dream.
Was it your idea, the whole selfie thing?
It's not.
Self-conceit.
I'm telling you, even the platform, many of the features, the crowdsourcing, I'm telling you,
he was struggling to touch his mother's crib while he was busy taking the selfie. That was not discovered. That was his own idea.
But I'm just asking, was it something that your team told him that every now and then, you know?
Because I don't
think he was not
impressed. But I would not allow that question, because it's not about technology, it's about an individual. Right? Let's keep this focus on technology. Right. It's not about personalities or parties.
I have a
maybe
question.
The
how were those humongous number of volunteers who came to work in the party on the set? How were they instructed to use this issue?
Were there any clear instructions?
Definitely. I mean, see, okay, to start with, I think one should appreciate the government, the EC, each of the party had to inform them, you know, the candidates' official accounts and the spokes, the person's thing also, the accounts, you know, the Twitter, FB, etc. So all those accounts were actually scanned all the time. Like, you know, if I were a spokesman, which I was not, if I told, you know, something about another person, the government would, like, you know, punish me actually. So it was that. But surely the people for, I am telling for, you know, I would say for all the parties, I'm sure they had the guidelines. Okay, but you know, the country is so large, you know, each guy has his own.
No, I'm not speaking about the election commission guidelines.
No, no, I'm thinking about
more
the volunteers.
Campaign strategy, as in if the ground grassroots or even the volunteers who volunteer for the campaigning, were they given any specific instructions to use social media?
No, I would not say that, you know, we told all those people that you need to be on Twitter, you know, you need to go to his page and, you know, hit the button for all his posts every day. I mean, all those things we were not doing at all. Okay, you know, those things were not doing. But surely there were few people who would say that I want to volunteer in the, you know, social media group, let us say. For example, if I want to be part of the group, then we would inform them about, you know, the language they can use. Even on their own account, even if they are not doing anything for the party, I mean, it had to be controlled.
I have a question to the panel.
Another small question. There was also a lot of flashing going on here in all kinds of fora. Again, all parties, irrespective of the party information. Then how was this app handled?
What is it?
Can you just give an example?
As in some abusive words and a lot of, for one comment, then you will get a...
Okay, we're coming to that, just hang there. So, we talked about the different types of social media tools and how parties use them. So, one of the things that I want to touch upon is obviously, this is what she's sort of leading to, is the signal-to-noise ratio. Right? So, how did you folks cope with it? That's part A of my question. And secondly, these different types of tools, how much of it do you target by strategy? How much of it you started reacting to based on updates? Because I'd be very keen to understand. So, could we touch upon it? So, in short, you got a question?
A little bit, but maybe.
Okay. The first question was more in terms of signals or noise.
Yeah.
So, let's
go
for that.
Yeah.
No, so, specifically, in answer to your question, for example, in our campaign, we. Although we originally had this concept that we want to get what we call digital volunteers, that people are not otherwise willing to do other things but only be on social media, we actually got very few people, and most of our likes or Twitter followers and all came sort of more organically. In fact, we never, being a ground campaign, we're always so much short of people on the ground that whoever would come would try to, you know, go and knock doors, you know, nothing like a live conversation, converting a voter. And as a result, I think, it's the pull of our candidate maybe, or you know, we got great traction on Facebook and Twitter, but it was not sort of us kind of giving directions to our volunteers to, you know, go and do certain things out there. The other thing was also the specific signal to noise ratio. We never encouraged any of our volunteers. I mean, we were very clear about maintaining decorum. We were, I don't think we...
No, I'm not asking the question that we encourage noise. My question is, on your Facebook page or your Twitter page for your campaign, you would have had good signal in terms of good feedback coming in, comments coming in, constructive.
Oh,
at the same time, you would have had lots of junk noise, like what you call, quote-unquote, what you call flash.
That stuff we were just...
Essentially, really not very nuts.
Okay, just like outright rude and out of behavior.
You do that on Facebook, but not on Twitter.
So you block the user,
but Twitter, it's also self-policing to a certain extent, right? So other people dump on the guy if they are being unnecessarily nasty.
We saw this ambush quite
a bit. How did you go about tackling it is what I'm interested in. Did you have like a core team just monitoring it to see what signal was noise or to cope with it? Actually, you have somebody watching those channels to say, hey, someone's passing some new parody on something, someone's spreading some misinformation, or someone's having a satire, or there's this nice joke going around, or whatever.
Okay, satire is good. My question is not about what.
It's about how did you manage to have a ear to the ground? What kind of teams went behind it?
How did you go about tackling it?
That's my question.
So we monitored for Facebook very closely. So of course, you can't monitor every post, but to the extent whatever's visible, whatever's visible on the front page, we made sure that it was sort of.
So there's also another point there, in terms of not exactly on your portals or on your websites or on your official web pages, but then things that went viral and which were public, available for consumption. So this is where you have to have, if you're a good political strategist, this is where you would monitor or you would see what is happening. Then how did you handle these things?
That is my question as well. How did they tackle those?
See,
things that went viral, where you don't have it on your official page, but then you have it as a public video or a public image.
One thing I just said, that this ecosystem is very huge. So it's very hard to know where what is happening. But when you use some of the tools and somewhere somebody posted and if it, trended or something like that and it went viral, the tools will be able to say that you got a lot of activity.
See, more likes,
so for any candidate, any party, they will be receiving, the good stuff. The bad stuff also is okay if it is the constructive. The one which you get upset is which is abusive and this and that. So, you have to learn to ignore. The one which you need to be very careful is if they cross the line where they threaten your life. Okay, then you need to see how serious it is.
So on the lighting note, since
I'm sure
the big data thing is about the fifth element, you're saying develop a thick skin and just go.
So how did, what is the strategy to influence the undecided voter? For example, a Modi buck would vote for Modi Bhumma, right? He would always, his comments would be more prominent in the social media. Okay. So how did you target the undecided voter?
See, I think, the only way was for us to be, spreading about, what his views was about, so many things, like either say the security. We used to have the post. When I say the security, not the big data security, the national security. Okay, so it's a little different. Yes, you see, one for the youth, the jobs. So like that, we had the post. Okay, and for some information, and the amount of information was on his blog, which he had made a public about the government reports, which showed that in so and so field, his state achieved that. So that is the only thing you can do. Two, you put the facts. Okay, and from there you have to see about what you have.
So let me rephrase some of the questions. Did you have a team that kind of had a counter campaign if there was a negative campaign of some kind? Or you just let it go as it
is? I'm sure everybody speaks about it, but I can assure you, at least in his team, all those things.
Well, when I said you, I meant. I didn't mean for you.
The thing is for any party, let me tell you. I'm speaking for any party or any of the candidates, sometimes you have some hardcore supporters on which you do not have like any control. Somewhere that he feels very strong about him or her. So he will be, firing the bullets in all directions. He can't do anything about it. So if we come to know about it, and if somebody says that XYZ is doing it, either they announce that he's not actually part of the team, and if he's got if he's agreed to hear, sometimes we inform them, on Twitter that you have to cool down or something. But you see, there are some people who make the noise. The number of followers they have on Twitter is like 5, 10, 15. So it's only he and himself who's, you're fantasizing that he's making a difference. That's the only thing.
The lady has a question.
Yeah, she's asking. Yeah.
Speech
the major findings of the study was quote-unquote, it's extremely abusive towards the elderly. My question here was the system of managing technical protecting in my social media. Were there any particular guidelines to ensure that, if somebody blocked the site to this about how there was the vulnerability security was extremely abusive to the point of threatening the memory in various ways, and this came out in the research as well. And even in making noise online,
If it's a question on policy, it's out of scope of this discussion.
No.
If it's a question on technology, I'll entertain
it. No.
Can you rephrase it?
No, I'll tell you.
No, if you want to rephrase your question around technology, I'm fine.
No, if you call it social media BGP, then was there any set of policies that this kind of
let me tell you.
Okay.
I'm telling you, no, your party in its right mind would ask their official volunteers to be sitting and abusing people. No, I'm telling you, and also, is it happening on the Twitter or on FB? Mainly Twitter, I would say. Because on the Twitter, I'm telling you, I can open an account and I can put any name I want and I can say that I am a supporter of XYZ. I mean, not me. Okay, I mean, not me. I'm from the rival party, but I will claim I'm a Modi supporter in the profile, and I'll be back.
I understand that, but my question is, since the social media claims that came up, was there any instance where you
No, the official volunteers would not do it. Right? But if you had sent a message that I, who am an official volunteer, I am doing it, then yes, action will be taken, definitely. If we know an official volunteer is taking action, it will be.
One aspect of social media I just want to add over here from a very different perspective is the fact that this is the first time that we saw social media overtaking the mainstream media. And this is something where we realize that, even mainstream television media, specifically say, wanted to encash on the social media boom. That's why every story that you saw on the English channels had a Twitter tag or that they wanted it to be tag on that. And this is something which clearly shows the growth of social media and the pace at which it is growing. Just to give you a small comparison, the social media this time was about 6 times more bigger than the television media in this country. And this is something which political parties did realize that, it is not just enough to sit with televisions, it is more important to be there with the social media because, one, as it was much bigger compared to television, and mainstream media this time was forced to follow social media.
What do you mean that 6 times is that the engagement or the cost?
Reach.
So okay. One last question. After each of the rallies, obviously you capture a lot of Facebook posts as well as Twitter mentions for all of these. Is there some way automatically that you identify the emotions in those? Was it whether positive, negative?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. What I must say that all that had to be done manually. While every the tool always said they are able to capture the the sentiment of the update, I think they completely failed on it. Completely failed. So we realized it had to be done manually. So, to some extent, we were able to say that some are positive, some are negative. Then again, we had to see in that body.
So, would you be in a position, just a follow up question, would you be in a position to share a little bit detail on the type of tools that you attended?
Yeah, I informed, your TrackX is one tool which we used. Okay, and I think the other groups they use SAP, I think they use SAP and Radiance 6.
So for what you guys?
For specifically for social media, we kind of use whatever tools are provided, either websites or whatever tools provide,
we didn't go beyond that. We did Google Analytics for our web properties. So
yes,
that's kind of thing.
My question.
Sorry,
the summarization that you mentioned that you provided as a report to OD. So that is a pretty humongous task.
It is humongous.
So that is manual. You did that entire thing manually.
No, we had to because of what he told. Because no, there is some amount of automation we can do, but we can't simply feed it into that thing and send the output.
So you're saying that you probably have to use the first level for the tools.
Some amount of surely automated. See, yeah, collecting the information itself is very difficult. We can't do that manually, right? So that from the tool we can do for each of the posts. We are able to download and the cleanups. And all of it.
Can you give some numbers around how many tweets you had to manually go through or post-summarization, post-cleanup?
Obviously it will be related to the size of the realm. Like if it goes to small town versus a big town, you have all of that. And it is also, about what he speaks. If it is something hits you, then the amount of the reaction you get is one. But it is like, sometimes, 20,000, 30,000, easy. That is a low number I'm talking about.
I know this is a very exciting topic, so I'd just like to get into two more questions and then throw it open a little bit. So far, we've covered how they use different tools in social media, how they deal with signal and noise, what kind of tools they use for it. And there were some questions around how did we deal with things like hate speech and stuff like that, sensitivity analysis and the like. So, we did touch upon a little bit in terms of what I call use cases or how they use this. The main thing that they talked about is engaging the public. That's the main use case. And in some cases, I did hear about getting digital volunteers or finding people who can help a party in the real world or otherwise. Were there other use cases that you used? Anything else?
Social media? Problem?
Yeah, any other use cases that come to your mind that besides these two?
The whole point of a campaign is persuasion, right? Persuading voters, your core base to vote for you, and the swing voters to make up their minds, help them, provide them with information that they may need to come, and change their minds and vote for you. So to that extent, it's a communication medium, just like regular media, but, Vijay ji mentioned that, there's an amplification effect. So for us, it was largely a communication tool. And of course, looking at what our opposition is doing, following their activities online, you get a lot of information just because they put it online. You don't have to follow them to see where they're going, but they put it up themselves, so that's kind of nice. But beyond that, I cannot imagine.
Sure. Any other use cases?
For us, the most important use of this was the crowdsourcing. Very well.
So are you planning to use this platform for in the future for running governance
as such? Yes. It is already in the papers. It's already in the paper. He has already launched the program where every resident asking them to volunteer for the country for 1 week or two weeks in every year. Not in a stretch. Every week after. So that is happening.
Yeah, may I request the audience to not ask party-specific questions, please? I'd like you to ask
questions. This is the government platform.
No, this is the government. It moves into governance, no, please.
No, the platform is.
This is focused on the elections, not look forward, look backward. Thank you. Because we should be very balanced, because the multiple parties on the panel, so it will be very fair in terms of what I have two other questions, and then perhaps we'll wrap up any questions from all of you. We'll get there. Yeah, I'll open it up for questions. Two questions. One, which is in terms of what would you think are the top two or three challenges each of your campaigns face from the top of your mind in terms of dealing with this beast of social media? It's been great, it's had its problems. What do you think are the top three challenges that you grapple with? We don't want to get into how you tackled it, more in terms of top of the mind challenges as you see.
So the challenges in a few fields, I would say, is to understand the demography of the user. If that we were able to have a better feel, so you would know whether the gender, age group, all of that. So that can the technology wise, in my opinion, the tools which are out there, the improvement which needs to happen is still a lot. Sentiment analysis, and see the example
if we do come to know a particular article or a particular post or tweet started going viral, so sometimes you don't know the cost, from where it happened, so why it happened. So that becomes hard. And we saw that sometime about 3-4 months ago, the amount of the traffic which was coming into the site and all the pages from the Pune had spiked. So the reason we don't know.
What about you? Any key learnings that you would call it?
So nothing particularly.
Rather challenges.
Challenges. Right? I mean, already things were touched upon, right? I mean, the problems of spam and sort of some volunteers getting whatever, right? I mean, I'm going crazy with bad language, hate speech. I mean, I wish that there were better ways to control some of these things, but it's just
a scale problem. I didn't hear anybody talk about it. Wasn't the magnitude of
because for us to handle the feedback, was
importance to regulate the social media or something. So that's something which is shown the damage it can do in terms of
the election commission has very specific rules for what you can, like, for example, let me say that we wanted to put a video out in the last few days of the campaign. And we had to take it to the election commission, stand in the BBMP office, then the officer watched the video. Then they took it, sealed it, put a stamp on it saying it was
totally.
No, it was done locally only. In fact, it approached quite fast. But the process is like, okay, I'm putting a seal on a CD. I mean, like, how does that. like, you'll have to use that CD. I'm like, okay, whatever, right? I mean, but. And there is a lot of regulations for hate speech on regular media that what you can do, cannot report, all that. But social media, by its very nature, there is always the worry that you'll over-regulate it, and there's those concerns. But then there's these kinds of concerns that the audience talks about.
Your digital, the campaign has to stop 48 hours before the date for the digital.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but the in the print on the day of the voting also you can have an ad. So I don't understand that.
That's a very fair observation. Okay, last question from me, which is, you guys have a lot of experience from running your campaigns this year, especially around social media, right? If you look at all your learnings and if you had to do things differently for your next campaign, what would be the two or three things that you would do very differently? Approach things differently to tackle it better. What would it be like the way you organize your teams or the way you look at
just from a social media perspective or
purely social media
perspective? It's at this point, I'm pretty happy with that. I think the key thing about social media is that the platforms, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn to a small extent, or G+. All of these have sort of created natural tools for you to disseminate your message that actually they do all the hard work for you. If you look at it, they'll make sure that people who might be interested in politics will automatically end up seeing a post somewhere in their feed at some point. So a lot of the hard work actually the platforms put behind you. From our side, I guess it's just as more and more people get online, I think the teams have to be larger, coordination has to be larger, more reporting, more. It's more of everything, but I don't foresee doing anything very differently from what we're doing this right now.
Yeah,
I'm
ready to answer the question. Right.
Yeah, so I'm sure in the the follow up on, say, elections, even if it's the state or the thing, in view of what everybody has seen, that it has worked quite well, I think the scale of operations will increase, especially if it is across the country. So I think that will only from one office to be doing for the country may be a little difficult. So the way I see is that, the planning in this field, I would say, it can be a little hard. Because to a large extent, who are the people who are going to get the tickets, usually only like 15 days before. So based on the candidate, then all the messages, the campaign material, all that needs to happen. So you can't do the planning for all the candidates like 6 months in advance. So all this happens in a very, very long time.
See, from the voters' perspective, what it needs to do is, we've seen the power of social media.
it's time that, you know, voters will have to come across maybe on a community-based group to be able to get more information about the kind of work that the elected representatives are doing, or the way, like, you know, we in the media, especially wait for the media to come to be able to get the criminal cases against a person and those kind of information. So maybe from that aspect, to be able to evaluate a candidate better, the voters or even the election commission will have to do something where the social media can be used more strongly to be able to give a clearer picture and a more transparent.
Sure. So you spoke about the power of Facebook. So Facebook also.
Maybe a little louder for the benefit of the
audience. Yeah. So Facebook, I think, did they sell ads in this campaign?
Yeah.
So they all did the parties buy these ads?
I think everybody has been doing.
Yeah, and it's fast that we saw one particular candidate's pictures everywhere.
So Facebook, in a way, the ads are very good because you are able to target the region, the gender, the age group, the profession.
One of the big talking points of this election was the amount of money that you were capturing. So technology was supposed to be a leveler, but from what we are hearing, it is bridging the gap even more. So, for example, a candidate with lot of money, for example, he would be more likely to run a technology-based campaign rather than somebody who does not have that. So, how do you see that gap getting bridged in the future?
So, technology on its own, I think you can't run it. It is going to be, you know, complimenting or whatever. You can't replace the door-to-door. What
I think his question is a little more nuanced. His question is more about money and technology. So it's like, is having more money makes you use more technology? Was his question. I mean, it's not about the technology.
No, I think you need a certain amount of expenditure, but I don't think just because you spend more money, you spend on more technology,
I actually think it's a slightly more nuanced question. You know, so when the web was new and blogging was new, one of the things that was said about it was that it gave publishing to the masses. Everybody now was on the same level.
Yeah.
Okay? And it seems like that's not the case anymore. Now, there are better users of technology and weaker users of technology, and there's a clear difference in their effectiveness.
Actually, it's the other way. I mean, depending on, you know, you look at the app example in Delhi, I mean, app is a phenomena of social media, that their spends are incredibly low. They it's just a product of, you know, social media today, right? I mean, and without that, I mean, I doubt that they would have been able to make the dent that they have made.
The real economics of elections is very different at the ground level. What we've seen in the past is abuse of money power. You know, where you have liquor distributed, money distributed. I will tell you from personal example. The Karnataka election 2011 in Tamil Nadu, where on an average 5 crores for an MLA constituency was given by the party. And that's the kind of money which went into, you know, that kind of distribution. End result, they did not even get about 10 seats. But so that's kind of, you know, see what happens over here with the social media and the growth that we've seen. The 10% voter increase, gradually the political parties are going to realize that whether you're going to put money into the wrong thing or you're going to put money into the right things. And technology that way is a far better investment, I would call it, instead of, you know, just dumping money, where you're able to communicate, you're able to think, but for this spoofs, spams, or, you know, this kind of stuff, if there is a better regulation, this is going to be a more cost-effective way than the kind of rallies, posters, banners.
See, the other important thing about this medium is the candidate or the party is in control of the platform. So sometimes what happens is the TV or the print, they pick only some one word what you use in the full speech, and they completely slice it, dice it, this, that. But here at least whatever you wanted to say, the whole thing will at least be there for the record. That thing will still happen. People will pick one sentence and, you know, bang on that. So that is
important. I have an add-on to what they said to your question. I think it's not as much as how much money they had, because if that was the case, every MP or potential MP in this company would have had the best sight and would have had the best form of communication. Because they all have money, because most of them would reckon have money. So I think it's not as much about money power to apply technology, it's more about what we discussed through this discussion about use cases or how you're applying it to either reach your voter or how you're convincing your voter. I think it's more about applied use cases than how you're applying it. So it's about finding the right guy to use the money that you have to apply the technology first. Okay. Perhaps that's the answer.
Does the technology expense
Yeah, does the technology expense also included into the maximum limit for the campaign?
I think they've already covered that. Most of it is done before the nominations.
So I had a question. Is the campaign spending limited only after nomination?
Yeah.
From the day of nomination.
Oh, so that basically, basically has no meaning at all.
Yeah.
Also, okay, we've asked so many questions to the panelists. I have a question to the audience on social media. Yours will be next. This one. So I have a question to the audience, right? I mean, forget the panelists for a moment. You folks experience the social media campaign, right? Or how they use technology as a whole. How many of you think that it was effective in you understanding either the party better or your candidate better? Raise your hands.
It's about the message, right? Not the media.
I mean, how many of you formed your opinion based on the technology?
I think it all depends on what kind of...
Now, I want a show of hands. I want individual opinion. How many of you thought that their campaigns of technology helped you form your opinion well? I mean, what did you think?
I think it's already...
But how much of it was, broadcast media? It's just a question you ask.
It wasn't only that, it helped solidify it from my perspective.
So in my case, I had no conventional broadcast media whatsoever. My use was entirely different. Which means that it was...
I just have one point to add. I think he has already made it clear that this was more biased towards Modi because he was the one who was maximum using it until the last 2-3 phases. So I think a lot of it came from one particular media, on social media at least. And then others jumped in and started using it a lot more. So that way, it is a little biased to answer this question. Well, that's my question.
No, my question is very generic thing, right? It's about how did you form your opinion?
I mean,
what
you say is the maximum input came from a single majority party.
Yeah, so what? Even if it came, he's asking, did you buy it? Did you form an opinion? It's okay, not a quantity.
My question is very beautiful.
The decision, did it help you?
See, it would be better if you rephrase the question that the social media campaign around the election affected yours or before that. Because for me, it was completely two different steps. Because around the election, I feel that this is mass marketing. But before the election, the natural organic sharing from your friends, right? That gave me a perspective, okay, some corruption is happening here, something is happening here, this guy is not doing this good. But once the election started, I get the feeling, oh, okay, all these are on social media marketing, somebody is paying and some agency is working together. Now, but what opinion I got out of it is I figured out who are my friends who support which parties. Okay. Except that no other educated guess I could make from the planned campaign. But before that natural campaign, people sharing corruption and all that, right? That get an educated perspective of which candidate and which parties what.
Okay, one other question. How many of you actually downloaded the party apps on your mobile phones? Show of hands. Nobody.
That's quite difficult.
The wallet
is so good. I mean, we thought about this and we were like, there's no incentive for you to download an app. I mean, it's just as pure simple as that.
Okay.
So that's just what I feel, satire as such, especially I saw Unreal Times, I followed Unreal Times very closely because I followed satire. I think satire is an extremely potent weapon for campaigning. Because the Unreal Times guys are kind of BJP supporters, but they acknowledge that. And they did a fabulous job of all of the satire, high quality stuff, and really beautiful messaging which I think, and it reached a huge target audience. And people love it.
Also, one more thing that I was really excited about was the use of technology in connecting these referendums. That seems to be in vogue now, right? Thanks to our other episode. But their methodology is somewhat hacky, I feel, versus votes and all that. But large use of social media
technology towards that might be great. So I think a bit mindful of time, we need to wrap up. So any last two questions from the audience? Because I need to
know from the technology perspective and more from involvement perspective. Were there any people in both your party, I mean your campaign groups, who were only focused on technology, wanted to get involved more for the sense of the excitement and the technology, and did not have, a bias towards the party itself? Do you have people like that in your group?
See, actually, I should say to you, the people who I work with over here, whom we actually hired, there's this separate team. So even before we hired, in the interview, we clearly told it's for whom. Because you do have few people who would say that I want to work, come what may, for him, I don't want to work for him, or I'm okay, those guys. So I didn't come across anybody who would say I don't want to. But
not weren't in neutral.
But actually, you know, few people were quite shocked who came to our this campaign office. You know, it was so low actually profile. We did not have any photos. We didn't have any flags. Even on the day of the results, we were just doing our work. We did not have those.
So you're saying it was just a business?
It's not a business. I would say it is professional. Professional would be a more because at least I was a volunteer.
That was
a
good question.
So I know of a company called Watson that was there in the US during the Obama campaign. They built tools and technologies around all of these elections for that they sold to individual candidates. I would like to know if you guys consider looking into that.
Yeah, but
something
else. So he's doing it.
Okay.
In
fact, so I don't have to share when we started. I said, so we did this work under the umbrella of a firm that we started called Fourth Line Technologies.
Okay.
And we'll see how this pans out.
All right, I'm not taking any more questions, but I'm going to give the panelists an opportunity to give the overall summary comments on technology and its use in the election, or maybe some forward-looking takes, as you may want to give the next 1 minute each for me to wrap it up.
Okay. So, I don't think I have anything more to add than you. I think you had a fabulous discussion. Thanks for your moderation. If I had to sum it up, I think, basically the numbers speak for themselves. You know, maybe 25% of the people are online in this election, and the next national election will probably see 50 or 75% online. I mean, I don't know what that number is. And as more and more people are online, as fewer and fewer people consume traditional media or are reachable through traditional means, there is no alternative but for campaigns to use technology to reach out to voters, to communicate their message and to present a professional face. So I just think we're getting started, and we'll see how the future will.
Rudy Vijay,
so you know, for me I would say even for the people who worked with me, I would say it's a fantastic opportunity, obviously, to work with somebody who had the vision on what had to be done, and in future will. The technology, because I think it will only increase. You know, it is the social media and the blogging as a medium. I mean, that is something they can't afford to ignore, especially after it has been proven. But is it something on which you can only bank on social media alone to win an election? I think that would be a stretch.
Well, I just want to make a joke. The fact is that, social media plays such a crucial role that Rahul Gandhi wanted the number of MPs to be below 50 so that he could create a WhatsApp group.
Any other closing comments? Okay. So I'll probably just take a minute or two to summarize. It was a very, very enlightening discussion. I enjoyed it a lot. Thank you so much for your wonderful perspectives and some great questions from the audience, which made many of us think more deeply. So my overall take on this whole thing is that it looks like technology is here to stay, and I feel that parties are still discovering how to really leverage the various different types of technology tools or the forms of social media, and probably learning as they go in this election. Some of them have been early adopters and have had good success with others, coming in and trying to kind of make similar things as well. But I would say that it's very evident from today's discussion that they still yet to define and determine more and more use cases that they can apply. They seem to have some preliminary success in some of the use cases. If you look at it in terms of how they're using it internally to target campaigns, or in terms of how they're getting people in the field to do, this, like they talked about the Jayanagar campaign, where they had some iPads given out or smartphones being used. I think that some of these early wins will perhaps get standardized in subsequent campaigns. And I think they will also probably spend a lot of time in terms of how they maximize the resources that they have in terms of benefits that they get from these various channels. I think this would have been a huge learning for them, and I think they would continue to try and see how they can maximize the impact of these channels. I would say a lot of the
the signal to noise thing that we talked about, maybe they were reacting to many of these quite honestly as well, because like some of them pointed out that it was difficult to even predict how to respond to some of those. And I think there were also some interesting regulatory aspects, which I think Vijay nicely touched upon in terms of what do the regulators do in terms of dealing with different forms of technology. And of course, there's this big problem of scale and language, which anyway we continue to have in this country, that continues to stay in the realm of this space as well. So it looks like there'll be more exciting times on how technology will be used in future campaigns and elections. And I hope you enjoyed this whole session, and I did thoroughly enjoy it myself. Thank you, every one of you, for being here, and thanks to the organizers, HasGeek, for giving us the opportunity to put this together. On a closing note, just want to remind you, maybe you might want to just move the camera there. We have the upcoming huge fifth elephant big data conference that HasGeek runs. It's an annual event that they run, and maybe you might want to just to say a couple of words about it before we wrap up. Thank you again for the opportunity.
So the fifth elephant is a conference on big data and analytics. It's mostly about what tools are available to deal with large volumes of data and what you do with those tools. So we look at storage, covering databases, current trends in NoSQL databases or SQL databases or columnar databases or so forth as one aspect of the event. Another aspect is the analytics side of it. How do you process very large volumes of data? 2 years ago, you would have said Hadoop is the way to do it. Nowadays, you say Hadoop is too slow, you need something that's more real-time. What do you do now? And so that's essentially the focus of this year's edition. This year is mostly about real-time analytics. How do you respond really quickly when you see a trend in your data? By really quickly, I mean like within a minute or something showing up in your data. That's largely the focus of this year's edition. So it's on July 25 and 26 is the conference, and 23 and 24 is the workshops. There are 2 days of workshops and 2 days of conference.
So where is it? Any?
The conference is at the Enhanced Convention Center, and the workshops will be at Perry, which is just down the road from here.
So thank you very much again, and may we have a big round of applause for the panelists.
Just a second. So that almost brings us to the end of our session today. So just I'm just left with the task of thanking our delegates here. So we are from HasGeek, we're thinking in the lines of having a run-up event for fifth elephant basically. So we had a clear thing in front of us, the 2014 elections. As you saw, the 2014 elections was well highly pitched with regard to social media, data, technology, much highly pitched than any of the previous editions. So we were pretty sure that we'll have a really nice evening, having all these people here. So let me start by thanking the party-based panelists who gave an unbiased review of how technology was actually used to power their campaigns. We had a lot of insights, like a lot of first-time things, technology was used for the first time to do some specific tasks, like Will mentioned, reaching out to 400,000 people in a matter of just 6 to 7 posts on Facebook. And like Mahesh mentioned, monitoring around thousands of volunteers through just WhatsApping and things like that. So thank you both of you for sharing your wonderful insights. And then again, Vijay for giving an overall view, an outsider perspective of how things were actually running in the current election scenario. So thank you, all three of you panelists. A round of applause for them. Mainly the villain of the evening, I was seeing from that view, he turned out to be the Dark Knight. He was showing stop signs for almost every one of you. So me first, then you. So that's the way it should have been done, because I especially thank Arun for turning converting this event into a much more interactive one, and not the usual lines of ending up in a Narendra Modi versus Rahul Gandhi aspect. So thank you, Arun, for moderating this session. And last but not the least, I thank all of you for finding time on a Friday evening, like we mentioned, instead of spending time in a pub or with family. It was
next time we can hold this event in a pub, I think.
Yeah, good option.
A spirited discussion. Yeah,
personally, I would love it even.
The talk will be something different.
So thanks a lot, guys, for spending your time. And yes, thanks to CAS also for giving us a wonderful venue to host this evening. Thanks one and all. And before we wind up, I just have a few goodies for panel members. So how can we go about with it? A dark t-shirt for the dark man.
Yes.
And how do we
go with it? I'm going to write.
Yes.
so you have the wife. And totally unbiased wife for you also. Matches just as the way your profiles match, did you have this to do that? Thanks, Ananda, for the
wonderful.
We just have some samosas and things here because we have a long way to go. Can you?
And you're welcome to ask as many questions as
you know.
They're still around.
On the samosas.
I'm not sure.